immortalized is the most exclusive club, and it's by invitation only. You can't buy a membership, you can't use political influence, you can't cheat your way into it. Everybody wants in. Presidents, kings, celebrities, political leaders create effigies and build monuments just to be immortalized. Dictators create a culture that's nothing short of idol worship. Children sing their praises every single day, all of this in an effort to be remembered. Think of what Muawiyah did. He tried every trick in the book, yet nothing remains of him in his own capital city. The only significant ancient structure that remains erect in Damascus is the shrine of Hussein's 3-year-old orphan. What this means is to become immortal, one has to pass crucial divine tests. To learn more on how we can gain access to the ultimate privilege, we explore the lives of a number of companions, ordinary people who became extraordinary. Looking for clues as to what turned them into the invincible forces of nature that shaped history despite being persecuted and in many cases, murdered. Individuals who carved their names in the annals of history as giants of devotion, faith, and sacrifice. Many are obscure to the average viewer, but that will be no more. These are their stories. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء وسيد المرسلين وحبيب إله العالمين أبي القاسم محمد وعلى آله الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين المكرمين الغرر الميامين سيما بقية الله في الأراضين وحجته على الخلائق أجمعين سيدنا وإمام زماننا وصاحب نعمتنا وولي أمرنا مهدي هذه الأمة وطاووس أهل الجنة الحجة ابن الحسن العسكري فداه أرواح العالمين. My dear brothers and sisters, السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. The road to glory, to immortality, to a lofty status, whether it be in this world or the next, is not going to be filled with roses and butterflies, but it's going to be riddled with challenges, with problems, with difficulties. That's how everything works in this life, let alone the next. The greater the reward, the greater the risk. The greater the pain, the greater the gain. If you want to achieve anything of value, anything of significance in this world of ours, you have to work really hard. You can't achieve anything of value, even material value, by goofing off and squandering your life and your time. You have to exert maximum effort. And so you can imagine that when it comes to achieving the greatest of all rewards, that of immortality, that of an eternal life, that of infinite bliss in the heaven that was created in order to accommodate a different set of physical laws where the standard Newtonian physics of our world simply don't apply. In order to achieve that, you need to work really hard. And the amount of challenges and difficulties that are going to come your way are going to be exponentially harder and bigger. Which is why when you look at those companions of the Imams of the Ahlul Bayt, individuals who appeared like they were perfectly ordinary human beings but ended up achieving extraordinary things, you know for a fact that that was not the product of a miracle. It wasn't a matter of them somehow being divinely inspired. I mean, we're not talking about infallible imams here. We're talking about ordinary people, normal individuals, just like you and I. People who come from all walks of life, from all manner of backgrounds and affiliations and ethnicities and languages and cultures And yet, they were able to achieve the greatest honor of all, to be immortalized, to be remembered for thousands and thousands of years. And that's only the tip of the iceberg. That's only their worldly reward. The fact that we remember them is nothing compared to what awaits them in the afterlife, in heaven, in paradise. These might have been peasants in this world. They might have looked like unassuming individuals that no one ever cared about. But in paradise, they'll be princes. In paradise, they will rule everyone. How did they do it? Well, the answer, as I said, is quite simple. It is hard work. It is devotion. It is having this goal and you being laser focused on achieving that goal. Once you figure out what your purpose in life is, once you realize that you're here temporarily and that your actions in this life will be reflected and amplified in the next, once you've figured out who to follow and who to take as your leader, the rest is a matter of just doing what you're supposed to do. Things become so much simpler once you know that Ali ibn Abi Talib is the Prophet's successor and that you have everything to gain from following him and everything to lose from abandoning him. And so this brings us to the emissaries of Imam al-Husayn alayhi salam, the special messengers of the Imam who carried classified letters from the Imam to those designated by him. We talked about two of them in the previous session. I want to talk about two more, essentially the last two of the four emissaries of Aba Abdullah al-Husayn. The third one is Abdullah ibn Yaqtar. Abdullah ibn Yaqtar was an interesting personality. Number one was the fact that he is considered Imam Hussein's half-brother. The reason for that is because his father used to be a servant in the house of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. Yaqtar al-Himyari. He came from the tribe of Himyar from Yemen. Once again, highlighting the significance of Yemen and the fact that so many of the companions of the Imams came from Yemen or were originally from Yemen. So Yaqtar al-Himyari, his father, Abdullah's father, was someone who would come and help out in the prophetic household. His mother was named Maymuna, and she was a servant in the house of Fatima al-Zahra alayhi salam. What an honor this was. And so historians say that Abdullah ibn Yaqtar was born about 3 days prior to Imam al-Husayn, which means that his mother Maymuna would have had enough milk to nurse more than one child. Now, you have to bear in mind the traditions tell us that Imam al-Husayn alayhi salam was not breastfed by any other woman. And so what this means is that Maymuna, the mother of Abdullah ibn Yaqtar, did not breastfeed Imam al-Husayn, but rather she was more of a nursemaid. She was someone who looked after Imam al-Husayn and helped out around the house. But the position of being called the half-brother of Imam al-Husayn was probably an honorary position that was given to this extraordinary man. So Imam al-Husayn alayhi salam sent Abdullah ibn Yaqtar to Kufa to deliver messages back and forth. Historians say that he went from the location of Imam al-Husayn alayhi salam, who was on his way to Kufa, and as he was approaching Kufa, he reached an area called Qadisiyah, which is considered one of the closest stations where people would, you know, caravans would stop and get some rest and get some food and whatnot. So he had all these stations along the route. When he reached Qadisiyah, the leader of the army of Ubaydillah ibn Ziyad at the time, or one of his top lieutenants, was a person by the name of Al-Husayn ibn Numayr. Now, those of you who have studied the passion narrative of Imam al-Hussein, the maqtal, the actual events of the day of Ashura, will in fact remember this name. It belongs to this wicked, vile creature who engaged in a conversation with Imam al-Hussein alayhi salam over water. He was one of the people who refused to offer Imam al-Hussein and his family and his children even a drop of water. And Imam al-Hussein responded to him with a prayer, which I don't want to get into at this point in time. But Hussein ibn Numayr, while the army was still in Kufa and hadn't yet set out to go to Karbala to confront Imam al-Hussein, this man was tasked with guarding the outer perimeters of the city. In other words, the borders of Kufa, to ensure that no one was allowed to come in, no one was allowed to leave. Martial law was of course declared in Kufa at the time. And Hussein ibn Numayr, and by the way, that's Hussein and not Hussein. So it's with the letter Saad as opposed to Seen. This individual was tasked with guarding the borders of the city, ensuring that this curfew, that this martial law remained in place. In fact, again, studying the history and the lives of the emissaries of Imam al-Hussein will provide you with a great insight as to the events leading up to the day of Ashura. And one thing that you can surmise from this is that there was a sense of absolute terror and fear that was imposed on the city of Kufa with the coming of Ubaydillah ibn Ziyad, ibn Marjana, may Allah curse him. And as an example, they say that while the city was under this very strict curfew, and Ubaydillah ibn Ziyad had made his intentions were no secret. He even came out and he made several declarations while he was still in Basra and after he arrived in Kufa, essentially saying that, listen, you know who I am, you know my family, I'm the kind of person who would kill my own uncles and my own cousins if I had to, right? He literally said that. And so you don't want to mess with me, you don't want to play with me, I don't play games. If anybody is suspected, so much as suspected, of having any connections with Imam al-Hussein or even an emotional attachment towards Amir al-Mu'mineen, was a crime punishable by execution. And so this is the kind of terror that was imposed on the city of Kufa. Hussein ibn Numayr was given clear instructions that you go out there and if anybody tries to come in or out, you intercept them and you bring them straight to Ubaydillah ibn Ziyad if they had anything of value to offer. If they didn't, then they would get executed. For example, they say that while the city was under curfew, this random Arab, this Bedouin, comes and somehow finds his way into Kufa. And of course, he's intercepted by the guards and the troops of Hussein ibn Numayr. When they catch him, when they get this guy, they say to him, what are you doing? He said, I was here, I came because there's a person in Kufa who bought some camels from me, but he didn't pay the price in full. And he told me to come and collect my money at this point in time. And so that's what I'm here to do. They told him, don't you know about the curfew? Don't you know that nobody's allowed to come in or out? And that anybody who's able-bodied has to head towards Karbala to kill Imam al-Hussein? Didn't you know that? He said, I had no idea, right? I just came to collect my money. So Hussein ibn Numayr said, look, you know, you have to go and make your case before the governor. So he took him to the governor's mansion to meet Ubaydillah ibn Ziyad. When he went there and he made his case, he told his story to Ubaydillah. Ubaydillah said the following, and I quote, he said, أَظُنُّكَ صَادِقًا, I believe that you're telling the truth, that in fact you have no ulterior motives, you have no agenda, you really are here because you had no idea what was going on, and you came to collect your money. وَلَكِنْ أُضْرُبُوا عُنُقَهُ, however, I want him to be executed so that he becomes a lesson to anybody else who's out there who might be thinking of doing something or who's hiding and whatnot. And he was executed. So this gives you an indication as to the kind of terror and fear and the iron fist with which Ubaydullah ibn Ziyad ruled Kufa in the days leading up to the day of Ashura. So, Abdullah ibn Yaqtar, as we said, Imam Hussein's half-brother, is intercepted while he was delivering a message to Muslim ibn Aqil at the station of Qadisiyah. Husayn ibn Numayr apprehended him and he sent him to Ubaydullah ibn Ziyad. Now, when he arrived in Kufa, Muslim ibn Aqil had already been executed. So the tragedy had already happened. He was there to deliver a message, but he was unable to do so. When they brought him to the court of Ubaydullah ibn Ziyad and had him stand before him, Ubaydullah said, listen, I'll make this very short. اصعد فوق القصر فلعن. I seek the forgiveness of Imam al-Zaman. But I'm just quoting this accursed man. He said, get up on the top of the palace, the governor's mansion, where everybody could see you. فلعن الكذاب ابن الكذاب. And I want you to curse the liar, the son of the liar. In reference to who? To the master of the youth of paradise. This was Bani Umayyah. This was the culture of Muawiyah. This was the culture of Khilafah that was created. The kind of ambience, the kind of atmosphere that they were trying to disseminate. So he told him, get up there and curse Aba Abdullah al-Husayn. ثُمَّ انزل حَتَّى أَرَى فِيكَ رَأِي. Then come down and then I'll decide what to do with you. In other words, he's giving him some hope that he might be released, he might be pardoned, but not a promise. So he said, sure, I'll get up on the rooftop if that's what you want me to do. فَصَعَدْ فَلَمَّا أَشْرَفَ عَلَى النَّاسِ. When he was in a place, in a position where everybody could see him, and you can imagine the city of Kufa was a city of hundreds of thousands of people, so tens of thousands at least are listening to this man, watching him, waiting to see what he has to say. Will he disown Imam al-Husayn or not? Will he curse Amir al-Mu'mineen or not? When he was in that position, he said the following, أيها الناس إني رسول الحسين بن فاطمة. I am the messenger, I am the emissary of Hussein, the son of Fatima, bint Rasulullah. He's identifying Imam al-Hussein to them. He's reminding them that if you are truly Muslims, then you should remember that Hussein is the grandson of your prophet. Inni Rasul al-Hussein ibn Fatima bint Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alih litansuruh. And I'm here to deliver this message to you, that you should support him, وتؤازروه, and to stand with him, على ابن مرجانة ابن سمية الدعي, against this son of مرجانة, the son of سمية, the bastard child of his mother. As soon as he said that, Ubaydullah ibn Ziyad said, push him off the ledge. So they pushed him off the ledge on the rooftop, which was the highest building in the city of Kufa. فوق القصر إلى الأرض. He fell to the ground. Allahu Akbar. أجرك أجرك الله يا صاحب الأمر والزمان. When he fell to the ground, they say فكسرت عظامه. His bones were crushed. وبقي به رمق. But he still had a trace of life in him. He wasn't dead quiet yet. فأتاه رجل. A man came to him by the name of عبد الملك ابن عمير اللخمي. This man, Ibn Umayr al-Lukhami, was one of the judges of Kufa. Imagine, you have a judge who is supposed to uphold the law. You have someone who's supposed to establish justice. This man, Abdul Malik al-Lukhami, came to him. He took out his sword. فَذَبَحَهُ. He slit his throat. And he slaughtered him as people were still watching. فَلَمَّا عِيبَ ذَلِكَ عَلَيْهِ. When they told him, how could you do this? Why would you slaughter this innocent man? قَالْ إِنَّمَا أَرَدْتُ أَنْ أُرِيحَ. His excuse was that I was trying to put him out of his misery. لَعْنَةُ اللَّهِ عَلَيْهِ. الشيخ المفيد, in his book Al-Irshad, he says that it was in the station known as Zubala, when the news of the death of this man, this honorable emissary of Imam al-Hussein, reached Aba Abdullah al-Hussein. Listen carefully to this, brothers and sisters. When the news reached the Imam, الشيخ المفيد says, فَخَطَبَ الْحُسَيْنُ فِي جَمْعٍ كَبِيرٍ مِنَ النَّاسِ. Imam al-Hussein got up and he delivered a sermon to a great crowd of people that were accompanying him. Now what this means is that the station of Zubala, which is on the way to Karbala, it's in the middle of nowhere. It's not a city. And what this tells you is that many, many people, hundreds perhaps, thousands, had accompanied Imam al-Hussein up to that point. Shaykh al-Mufid explains that the reason these people were with the Imam is that ظنوا أن الحسين يريد أن يدخل الكوفة فاتحا. They were thinking that Imam al-Hussein is going to enter the city of Kufa as a conqueror. He's going to liberate Kufa and he's going to establish his dominion there. And so they probably thought to themselves, let's join in. Maybe we'll get a piece of the pie. Maybe we'll be appointed in sensitive government positions. Maybe we'll be able to collect some money and booty and so forth. And so they were there in order to benefit from Imam al-Hussein. Not so they would fulfill their pledge to the Imam. Not so they would fulfill their promise to Rasulullah, who said, Al-Hasan wal-Hussein imaman qama aw qa'ada. Hasan and Hussein are leaders. You must follow a leader. You must obey a leader. They weren't there to do what they were supposed to do. They were there for the spoils of war. Sometimes when we pray for the reappearance of the Imam, if we dig deep down, we'll discover that our intention is no different to many of these people who came with Imam al-Hussein to these later stations on his way to Karbala. We'll find that our intention is, well, maybe the Imam will come and he will rid us of these problems. Perhaps the Imam will come and we'll have a better economy, we'll have a better standard of living, we'll be living in a world that's peaceful and there's less wars and there's less problems. When in fact, that shouldn't be our intention. Our intention should be, oh God, send your proof. Send your representative. Send your guide. Send the Mahdi so that we could serve him. Imam al-Ridha alayhi salatu wassalam says that I wish I were there when he reappears so that I could serve him. لَخَدَمْتُ. Either Imam al-Sadiq or Imam al-Ridha alayhi salam, they've been quoted as saying this. Our intention should be, let the Imam return so that we could be at his beck and call. We could be at his service. We could try and help relieve some of the pain, some of the misery that he's been experiencing all this time. Ya Hujjat ibn al-Hasan, make us among your servants. Make us among your slaves. As we say to Imam al-Hussein when we visit him, what do we say? How do we address the Imam when we stand at the entrance of the shrine, the mausoleum of Aba Abdullah? We say, عبدك وابن عبدك وابن أمتك جاءك مستجيرا بك. Here is your slave, Ya Aba Abdullah. Make me at your service. اللهم استعملني في دينك ولا تستبدل بي غيري. The most beautiful dua is this, Oh Allah, hire me, make me among your servants and don't replace me with other people, because I know you have a lot of candidates. I know you have a lot of people who are more qualified than me, who are better than me, who are more pious than me. Oh Allah, make me the right candidate. Make me your servant by allowing me to serve under the banner and the standard of Al-Mahdi, Al-Hujjat ibn al-Hasan al-Askari. May our lives be ransomed for him. So when Imam al-Hussein got up in the midst of these hundreds or thousands of people who had gathered with him, he broke the news to them like this. The news of the killing of Abdullah ibn Yaqtar. How did he break the news? The Imam said, Atana khabarun fadi' bi abi anta wa ummi ya Aba Abdullah. Terrible news has reached me. قتل مسلم بن عقيل وهاني بن عروة وعبد الله ابن يقطر. The Imam said, these three have been killed. وَقَدْ خَذَلَنَا شِيَعَتُنَا. And the people who claim to follow us, the people who claim to love us, which is not a reference to the Shia, it's a reference to basically every Muslim. Doesn't every Muslim say that they follow Imam al-Hussein? Except to the Nasabis, the Wahhabis. I have nothing to say to them, but everybody else, every Muslim, wherever they are, all over the world, don't they claim to love Imam al-Hussein? Don't they claim to respect Abu Abdullah? Don't they take Imam al-Hussein as an imam? But they abandoned him. The true Shia of Imam al-Hussein were Habib ibn Mudahir, Muslim ibn Awsajah. The true Shia of Imam al-Hussein were the ones who were killed alongside him on the plains of Karbala. The rest abandoned him. فَمَنْ أَحَبَّ مِنْكُمُ الْإِنصَرَافِ. Listen to this bit. The Imam said, so whoever wants to leave, now that you know that my emissaries have been killed, if you wish to leave, فَلْيَنْصَرِفْ غَيْرَ حَرِجٍ. You could leave now and don't be embarrassed. Don't feel that if you leave, I will be upset. فَلْيَنْصَرِفْ غَيْرَ حَرِجٍ. لَيْسَ عَلَيْهِ ذِمَامٍ. In fact, I relieve you of your pledge. I relieve you of your allegiance. You can leave. بِأَبِي أَنْتَ وَأُمِّي يَا أَبَا عَبْدِ اللَّهِ. الشيخ المفيد says, فَتَفَرَّقَ عَنْهُ أَغْلَبُ النَّاسِ يَمِينًا وَشِمَالًا. When the Imam said that, most of those who were in the crowd, they started to abandon the Imam from the right and the left. وَلَمْ يَبْقَ مَعَهُ إِلَّا أَهْلُ بَيْتِهِ وَنَفَرٌ قَلِيلٌ مِمَّنْ وَطَّنُوا أَنفُسَهُمْ عَلَى الْمَوْتِ. The only ones that remained and stayed back were his family and a small group of people who had already committed themselves to die. Die for Hussein, die for the truth, die for justice, die for morality, die for God. وَطَّنُوا أَنفُسَهُمْ. They had already made that pledge, that commitment. They'd made their promise between them and God. They had no hesitation, no qualms about it whatsoever. وَطَّنُوا أَنفُسَهُمْ. And see, that, brothers and sisters, is where most of us falter. Most of us fail to make the commitment. Forget trying to follow through with our commitments. We don't even want to make the commitment. It's like when people have sins that they want to get rid of, right? But they just can't make the commitment to rid themselves of those sins. Once you make the commitment, if you're serious, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will help you. عَلَىٰ قَدَرِ النِّيَّةِ تَكُونُ مِنَ اللَّهِ الْعَطِيَّةِ. As Amir al-Mu'mineen says. You make the pledge, you make the commitment, make the promise, Allah will help you. He will give you the boost, He will give you the backing, He will give you all the resources you need to follow through with your commitment. Anyway, the fourth and final emissary of Imam al-Hussein is a man by the name of Qais ibn Musahhar al-Saydawi. Salamullahi alayhi. Yet another inspiring personality. Yet another extraordinary man who rose from ordinary beginnings. Humble backgrounds, and yet he was able to carve his name in the list of the true loyal servants of Hussein, alayhi salatu wassalam. Why was he important? Well, part of it was that he was the fourth and final emissary of Imam al-Hussein before reaching Karbala, before the tragedy befell on the day of Ashura. He also made it to Qadisiyah. There was a lot of back and forth. I don't want to get into it at the moment. Imam al-Hussein sent him to Kufa to take the letters of the Kufans and deliver them in Mecca. He then came to Mecca, stayed there only for 3 days. And you know, as I am researching their history and I'm looking through all these details, I can't help but be left in absolute awe of these personalities. Think about how hard it is, for example, for someone to travel all the way from Kufa to Mecca. Kufa is in the south of Iraq. Mecca is in the western part of Hijaz. To go from Kufa to Mecca, you're talking, what, thousands of miles, maybe 1,000 or 2,000 miles? I mean, the trip alone, how arduous that must have been. How difficult is that? In fact, I believe At-Tabari says, if I'm not mistaken, at least one historian, probably it's Tabari, says that in one of these trips, when he was going back and forth between Mecca and Kufa, he took two guides to show him the way. And the two guides, they came across this very dry patch of desert where there was no water, and they must have lost their way, or something must have happened, that the two guides died of dehydration. Every trip that they took was full of risk, was full of difficulty and trial and pain and death. And yet most of us, subhanAllah, not most of us, some of us, when it comes to salat, we find it so difficult. When it comes to waking up for Fajr, how embarrassing is that? There's a reason why he ended up being Qais ibn Musahhar al-Saydawi alayhi salam, and I am who I am. This miserable speck, this worthless, disobedient servant. The difference between them and us is that when they committed themselves fully. He travels all the way from Kufa to Mecca, and then he spends only 3 days to rest in Mecca. Then Imam al-Husayn calls him. He gives him another letter and he says, deliver this to Muslim ibn Aqil. Next time when you're faced with a religious obligation and you feel too tired or too embarrassed or whatever the case may be, remember Qais ibn Musahhar al-Saydawi. Remember the emissaries of Hussein. So Imam al-Hussein sends him. As I said, he was the final emissary, the final messenger. So he gets captured once again in Qadisiyah, which was the closest station prior to Kufa. Who caught him this time? It was again al-Hussein ibn Numayr, la'natullahi alayh. So the encounter is rather interesting. They say that as soon as Qais realized that Hussein and his men had intercepted him and had seen him, he immediately took out the letter that was given to him by Imam al-Hussein to be delivered to Muslim ibn Aqil and Hani ibn Urwa and the other prominent Shia in Kufa. He took out that letter and he started to tear it up because he realized that he's going to get captured. There was no way he could escape. So before he gets captured, he starts to tear up the letter, and then just to make sure they can't read the contents or know what's inside the secret message or who it's addressed to, he tears it up and starts to eat it. Now, we're not talking about a piece of paper. We're talking about a piece of goat skin. مزقها, he tore it up into small pieces and ate it just in time. When Hussein ibn Numayr and his men captured Qais, he had already eaten all of the pieces. Hussein didn't know what to do with him. He said, who are you? What are you here to do? He said, I'm not speaking to you. He said, I'm going to take you to Ubaydillah ibn Ziyad, the notorious despot. And he will have to decide what we're going to do to you. So he takes him to Ubaydillah ibn Ziyad. When he arrives in the governor's mansion, the palace there, Al-Allamatu al-Majlisi, Ridwanullah ta'ala alayhi, is the one who narrates this encounter. I mentioned this from Bihar al-Anwar. He says that when Qais came, as soon as they brought him in, Ibn Ziyad said to Qais, he said, who are you? Qais said, Ana rajulun min shi'ati amir al-mu'mineen, Ali ibn Abi Talib wabnihi alayhim as-salam. I am one of the followers of Amir al-Mu'mineen, the commander of the faithful, Ali and his son, may God's peace be upon them. Now, right here, before we move on any further, that statement was a death wish. The moment you say you are related or you have any affiliation to the commander of the faithful and Imam al-Husayn, you're done. You know that for a fact. And yet, Qays ibn Musahhar could not care less. This is what a true Shia is. Ibn Ziyad said to him, فَلِمَاذَا خَرَقْتَ الْكِتَابِ? Why did you tear up the letter that you had in your possession? Qays said to him, لِأَلَّا تَعْلَمَ مَا فِيهِ? So you would know what's in it. In other words, he's not even trying to hide his intentions. He's not trying to hide his motive. He knows what's coming. He knows who Ubaydullah ibn Ziyad was. He knows who Ibn Marjana was. He knows who Yazid is. لِأَلَّا تَعْلَمَ مَا فِيهِ. So you wouldn't read it. That's why. Ibn Ziyad said to him, وَمِمَّنِ الْكِتَابِ وَإِلَى مَنْ? Who sent the letter and to whom was it sent? Qays ibn Musahhar said, مِنَ الْحُسَيْنِ ibn Ali. It was sent from Imam al-Husayn. إِلَى جَمَاعَةٍ مِّنْ أَهْلِ الْكُوفَةِ لَا أَعْرِفُ أَسْمَاءَهُمْ. But it was sent to a group of people in Kufa. I don't know what their names are. He doesn't want to disclose the names because merely saying those names means they're dead. فَغَضِبَ إِبْنُ زِيَادٍ. Ibn Ziyad was enraged. He said to him, وَاللَّهُ لَا تُفَارِقُنِي حَتَّى تُخْبِرَنِي بِأَسْمَاءِ هَؤُلَاءِ الْقَوْمِ. You will not leave this place until you give me each and every one of those names to whom the letter was addressed. But I'll give you another choice if you don't want to give me those names, because he knew that he wouldn't give those names. If you don't do that, تَصْعَدِ الْمِنْبَرِ, I want you to sit, ascend the pulpit, وَتَلْعَنَ الْحُسَيْنَ بْنَ عَلِيٍّ وَأَبَاهُ وَأَخَاهُ. And I want you to curse Hussein and his father and his brother. Now, you have these two choices, he said. وَإِلَّا قَطَّعْتُكَ إِرْبًا إِرْبًا. If you don't do either of those, I will cut you into small pieces. Now, imagine you have these two choices. Either you get up there and say a few things, disavow your imam, say that you don't love him, curse him if you must, because the alternative is being not only being killed, but being cut into pieces. Qays said to him, أَمَّا الْقَوْمُ فَلَا أُخْبِرُكَ بِأَسْمَائِهِمْ. Let me make this easier for you. As for those names, they won't be disclosed to you. I won't tell you anything. أَمَّا اللَّعْنْ فَأَفْعَلْ. As for cursing, I will do that. Let me sit on that pulpit. Now, of course, you know where this is going. We're talking about the companions of Aba Abdullah. We're talking about the martyrs of Karbala. فَصَعَدَ قَيْسٌ الْمِنْبَرِ. Ubaydullah, having threatened Qays with being killed and cut into pieces, probably thought that maybe he's going to say something which will break the resolve of the people of Kufa. In case there was anyone who was still thinking about joining Aba Abdullah, that would be the end of it. So he said, go get up on the pulpit. And then he announced to the entire city of Kufa that everyone should go and assemble in the masjid. So Qays ascended the pulpit. فَحَمَدَ اللَّهَ وَأَثْنَى عَلَيْهِ. He praised God. And then he sent his peace and salutations upon the Holy Prophet and started to praise Amir al-Mu'mineen Ali ibn Abi Talib and his children, salawatullahi alayhim. Then he started cursing Ubaydullah ibn Ziyad wa Abah. He said, may God curse Ubaydullah and his father, Ziyad ibn Abi. May Allah curse Bani Umayyah. عَنْ آخِرِهِمْ, every last single one of them. And then he said, أَيُّهَا النَّاسِ أَنَا رَسُولُ الْحُسَيْنِ ابْنِ عَلِي. I am the messenger of Hussein, the son of Ali. وَقَدْ خَلَّفْتُهُ بِمَوْضِعِ كَذَا. And I left him at this exact location. He gave them the coordinates. He said where Imam al-Hussein was now staying, in what station prior to Kufa. فَأَجِيبُوهُ, so answer his call. Go to him, support him. فَسَارَ عَبْنُ زِيَادٍ بِجَلْبِهِ. When he started saying these things, He essentially delivered the message of Imam al-Hussein to the people of Kufa. As soon as he said that, Ibn Ziyad said, "Bring him down." They brought him down. They then took him to the rooftop of the governor's mansion, the governor's palace. فَرَمَوْهُ مِنْ أَعْلَى الْقَصْرِ They threw him to the ground. فَاسْتُشْهِدْ He was martyred. وَلَمْ يَكْتَفِ الْعِينِ Listen to this. As if that wasn't enough, he then said, "Now bring me his body, and I want you to cut it up into small pieces." فَقَطَّعَ جَسَدَهُ إِرَبًا إِرَبًا اللَّهُ أَكْبَرُ الطرماح ابن عدي الطائي, and we talked about him in a previous session, was the one who left Kufa after everybody else, after all of these events had taken place, and he came and met Imam al-Hussein alayhi salam along the way. He was the one who delivered news of the killing of Qais ibn Musahhar. Historians say, فَلَمَّا سَمِعَ الْحُسَيْنُ بِذَلِكَ تَرَقْرَقَتْ عَيْنَ الْإِمَامِ Imam al-Hussein started to cry, and then he said, فَمِنْهُمْ مَنْ قَضَى نَحْبَهُ وَمِنْهُمْ مَنْ يَنْتَظِرُ اللهم اجعل لنا ولهم الجنة منزلا Oh Allah, make paradise for them and for us, our abode. واجمع بيننا وبينهم And reunite between us في مستقر رحمتك In your, under your mercy ورغائب مذخور Oh Allah, bring us back together once again. Imam al-Hussein, these were his brothers. These were his companions. These were his loyal supporters. He cried and he then told everyone of the news. In fact, in Ziyarat al-Nahiyah, the ziyarah attributed to the 12th Imam, may Allah hasten his reappearance, there is a statement like so. As-salamu ala Qais ibn Musahhar al-Saydawi. Imam al-Zaman sends his blessings upon Qais ibn Musahhar al-Saydawi in his ziyarah. Now, Imam al-Hussein, when he bid his son farewell, he cried and he raised his hands towards the heavens and prayed that God would punish those who were about to sever the lineage of Aba Abdullah al-Hussein by killing his son Ali al-Akbar. The Imam even spoke to Umar ibn Sa'd. He said to him, Ya Umar ibn Sa'd, قَطَعَ اللَّهُ رَحِمَكَ كَمَا قَطَعْتَ رَحِمِي May God sever your lineage just as you severed my lineage. The Imam cried in such a manner that was different from all the others. Obviously, people might say it's because Ali al-Akbar was the Imam's son. Others might say it was because Ali al-Akbar resembled the Holy Messenger of God, the most beloved person to the heart of Aba Abdullah. People might say that because Ali al-Akbar was so young and so full of life and hope, he had a future. And yet he was killed and his lineage was severed. And all of these reasons may be true, but perhaps one of the reasons was that the Imam knew, and Ali ibn al-Akbar knew, that he was going to be killed on behalf of Imam Zain al-Abidin alayhi salam. There are many indications that the enemy thought Ali ibn al-Akbar, who was an older brother to Imam al-Sajjad, was the Imam and the successor of Aba Abdullah. And in a way, that was how it was staged. In order to deflect attention from Imam al-Sajjad, Ali al-Akbar sacrificed himself. One of those reasons, one of the indications that make us think and believe that when they killed Ali al-Akbar, they thought they were in fact killing the Imam after Imam al-Hussein, is the manner with which they killed him. Hussein.